Welcome to another episode of HR Leaders Live, the podcast where we discuss the future of work with today's most innovative and successful people leaders. My guest on today's show is the highly energetic. you're outdoing me today, Neen. Neen James who is a leadership expert, keynote speaker, and author of the book Attention Pays: How to Drive Profitability, Productivity, and Accountability. Tell our listeners a little bit about yourself, Neen, and then we'll jump in to the show.
Well, Chris, I grew up in corporate business in Australia. People probably realize this is not an American accent. It's definitely not a UK accent. Although, you know, most Australians are originally convicts, I guess. So we're probably related somehow. But I grew up in corporate business in Australia. I worked in retail banking, telecommunications, and the oil industry in Australia. There's not a lot of chicks in oil. But in that role, you know, as an attention expert, I'm obsessed with getting the world to pay attention. And I think when you think about the future of work, we have all of these generations in the workplace right now. And so I love the opportunity to work with people like that. I get to work in the US and around the globe with super cool clients like MTV, Comcast, Viacom, Johnson & Johnson, all kinds of people, from everyone from their C-suite all the way through. And So I guess when you think about it, I'm like the Energizer Bunny for a meeting. But we were joking about the energy before we came on today. Something that's unique about me, Chris, is that not only being an Australian, I see the world through a very global perspective, but also I became an American citizen, so I see a very local perspective as well. I'm the oldest of five. I sound like I'm five, one of the things that fascinates me, Chris, is it doesn't matter whether it's an HR leader, a CEO, or someone who's on the front line, I constantly hear them say things like, gosh, there's never enough hours in the day. Or they say things like, there's so much to do, I don't know where to focus first. Or I'm completely overwhelmed.
You sound like me.
Yeah, but it's so many of us. And I fix that because often as the keynote speaker, I will go in to open an event with a high level of energy with super practical strategies they can apply immediately. Or maybe we're chatting around a board table, or maybe I'm working with someone one-on-one. See, the reason I do what I do, Chris, is I just want the world to pay attention. Because when we pay attention, our relationships are deeper. Companies make more money and we take care of the planet on which we live. So that's just a little bit about me.
Amazing. That was like the quickest intro ever. Very straight to the point, keeping everyone's attention. So how did you hone in on this topic then?
You know, I think in my corporate days, I was always the girl who could get stuff done. You know, like in every team, there's a person who has this capacity, right? So we joke about, you know, give a busy person something to do, you know, they'll get it done. And I was super productive and I was often inheriting. I remember one project I got in the oil industry. I inherited this project, Chris. It was 10 months behind. I had 2 months to raise $10 million. I mean, it was stupid, but I did it. But what was amazing was that I was that girl who just knew how to get things done. And I assumed the world was productive. When I left my corporate role to set up my own company, people kept asking me, come teach my team how you did that. I'd be asked to speak at a best practice conference. Go tell us how you did that. And so I think that I just assumed the world was productive, but lo and behold, it's not. And then I wrote a book about it. I developed a speaking business and a training company. And then we relocated to the US. And then I had to start all over again. So what I realized very early in my research and in my speaking career is you can't manage time. Like, time's going to happen whether you or I like it or not. Time doesn't care. We get the same 1,440 minutes in a day. So if you can't manage time, what I realized is you can manage your attention. And that set me on this path to be obsessed about what are the choices that we're making around our time, attention, and energy, which is how Attention Pays, my latest book, was born.
When did you decide at that point where, you know, what was the inspiration around bringing the book out, just to spread the message as much as possible?
You know, interestingly, I had written a book called Folding Time, and Folding Time, I declared to the world, there's no such thing as time management. That's a stupid concept. Nobody can do it. It's going to happen anyway. But then I had to back it up, right? So I started to explore this idea of managing energy. So many, many years ago, I wrote Folding Time. But then the conversation evolved because technology changed the pace at which we work. We now have nearly five generations work in the workplace, which a lot of the leaders who listen to your show know that. We also are having different demands on our time. There's no such thing as like boundaries anymore. I mean, you're too young, honey, God bless you, but there was a time where like people would go to an office and then they would have like an in tray, and people watching this may actually remember.
Listen, I had that too, you know. Okay. I started my corporate career at 17.
Okay, all right, so then you get so a pass.
I had a file of fax with Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Okay, all right. So
and I had no computer. okay. at my desk. There wasn't a computer at my desk. It was a file of fax on a phone.
I remember life before email. I mean, I sound like I'm five, but you need to add a zero and we're getting closer, you know? So, but what I found was that the best leaders I knew, the highest performing leaders, they were getting ahead because they were focusing on really what matters. And so sometimes that means understanding, well, what do I need to say no to in order to say yes to things that matter? You know, if you think about it from an HR point of view, HR leaders are exceptional at promoting everyone else. They're brilliant at taking care of everyone else. They're phenomenal at meeting the needs of the people around them. They are a strategic advisor to the C-suite where they sit in on meetings where they're influencing the entire company. And yet, some of my HR leaders are the worst at self-care. They're the worst at telling the world how great they are because they're brilliant at doing it for everyone else. And so what I realized is that this attention, there are internal and external factors that impact our attention. And once I started to explore that, Chris, attention gets a bad rap. I mean, you think about it. We're like, oh, she just wants attention, you know? And it's got this negative connotation, and yet attention is just about connection. And that's what so many of your listeners, people who are watching today, that's what they do. They're all about connection.
So what are some of the common misconceptions around attention?
I think that one of the most common things is that people feel like they need all the attention. And here's the thing. People don't need a lot of attention. They just need attention from the right people. Right. So if you are a leader, your direct reports, your team, they require your attention. If you share your home with someone, they require your attention. Right. So we don't need a lot of attention. We just need attention from the right people. Another misconception is that everyone claims they have ADD. And the challenge I have with that is my little brother, I grew up with someone in my family who had ADD or now ADHD. And that's a true thing. But what happens is people say, oh, I just have ADD. And they make it a very flippant thing. And it's a genuine thing. But I think we're living in this attention deficit society, Chris, where we are using things like that as an excuse for laziness, right? Mm-hmm. I think another thing is that people just flippantly throw it away. It makes me crazy, if you can't already tell, because it is a true medical condition. I think it does need to be medicated. Now, when you also think about the fact that people right now, they feel like, I think people are addicted to busy. And here's what I mean by that, Chris. They're like,
just because you're being busy doesn't mean you're being productive.
Yeah, it doesn't mean you're paying attention to the right things.
Yeah.
So people have all these massive long to-do lists. They fill their days up with meetings, conference calls, you know, checking the email. They get to the end of the day and they're exhausted. They don't feel like they've done anything because they haven't spent their attention on the most impactful things. And so one of the misconceptions, Chris, is, well, if I just stay busy, I'll get it done. Or if I just make another to-do list, I'll get it done. Or if I just get to the bottom of my inbox, I'll get it done. And that's not true.
You talk about the three types of attention. Can we jump into that?
Yes, absolutely. When I was researching attention pays, you know, how do you give something like attention something tangible for people? And yeah. So in my research, what I realized was there's really three ways we pay attention. People may want to write this down. The first way we pay attention is personal attention. This is about who deserves your attention, right? This is about being thoughtful. So the book is full of strategies to do that. And so when you think about it, there is kind of like your most intimate circle of people who need your attention. There's your immediate, you know, clients and team members and things. And then there are people on the outside of that. So when you think about it, if you have less time, the most quality time should go to your most intimate circle. If you have more time, then you can expand your circle. So the first way we pay attention is personal attention. The second way we pay attention is professional attention. And professional attention is about what deserves your attention. This is about being productive. This is make sure that you're spending your attention on the most impactful activities, the projects and the priorities that are going to get you closer to your goals. And then the third way we pay attention is global attention, which is how you pay attention in the world. This is about being responsible. Now, your world might be your community, your church, your temple. It might be the community in which you serve. It might be all the boards that you sit on. There's so many different ways to expand the world concept. But the three ways we pay attention, personal attention is about who deserves your attention.
Yeah.
Professional attention is about what deserves your attention. And global attention is about how do you pay attention in the world. Let's be more thoughtful, let's be more productive, and let's be more responsible about the way we contribute our attention.
I had to do something similar recently, and because I got to the point as we're growing and scaling this business that I was just focusing on too many things. Mm-hmm. And I had to sit down and write everything out and be like, where should I be adding, focusing my time and attention?
Yes.
And, which of these things are adding the most value and, you know, stepping me forward in the direction that I want to go? And there were so many things that I cut out of that, which, and now it's sort of leapfrogged us to the next stage of our business, because actually doing less things, but having more impact with the things I am doing, they're getting me closer to my goals.
I think that's so powerful, because you took the time to do an audit. You know, if people do an attention audit of what is really distracting them right now, and mm-hmm. what are the things they're spending their time on. Now, some things are like more fun to spend time on, right? Now, the one thing that I always say to my executive teams is think about your day like a road trip, right? So if you are going on a road trip, say you're traveling across the country and you go to pack the boot of your car. In America, they call it the trunk, right?
Yep,
so
yep.
you have all this luggage that has to go in your car. So I would ask you, Chris, if you're going to pack the trunk of your car or the boot of your car, what would go in there first?
My people.
your people. We want them in the car, right? Yeah. You're not going to put them in the back of the car, right? You're going to put them in the trunk. So let's just say that maybe the largest luggage items, they're going to go in first. Then you're going to smush in everything else around. You're going to fit it in. And what I often say to my executives and to my audiences around the world is that your day is like a road trip, but the large luggage items need to go in first.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Then we smush in everything around it. But what happens is a lot of people, they get their to-do list and then they cross off the little things because they feel good about getting some little things done.
And they're the easy things to do.
Yes, Chris, that's exactly right. And then the large luggage doesn't get done. And so if you think about large luggage, like goals people have, objectives, new programs they want to set up, maybe they want to implement a new onboarding program, maybe they want to revise their learning and development strategy. Maybe their benefits need to be overhauled. Maybe they need to create a career fair. These are big projects that might be on their agenda. But it's so much easier to attend the next meeting, clear the next email, and then answer the phone rather than do the work that's going to get them closer to their goals.
Could you share some of the other sort of practical examples in those three areas?
Sure.
Give people in the book just a few. I appreciate there's loads in the book, but
one of the things that I love a good system. One thing I'm known for, Chris, is my systems thinking. I look at the world in systems. If there's a system for it, I love it, because systems create freedom. And so when it comes to personal attention, I have what I call systemized thoughtfulness. Now, I know that sounds a little harsh, but let me give you an example, right? So systemized thoughtfulness. When you think about a cell phone, you know, people are often very addicted to their technology. But technology is not the enemy of our attention. We are, right? We choose to be on these devices. But the way that I use it, one system that I have, is I fly every week, multiple times a week. So I find myself, because of my work, I'm always in airports, hotels, and convention centers. It's, you know, it's what I do. I love what I do. But before I get on every plane, I make sure I shoot at least a couple of text videos and send them to people. Now, what this does, it's a system, right? Because often, you know, when you're sitting at the gate and you're waiting for the plane to come off, you're not allowed to be on your laptop, but there's nothing really happening. So I will often open my phone, shoot a short video and say, hey, Chris, I had so much fun being on your podcast. I loved being on LinkedIn Live with you. Had the best time, and then I'll send it to you. So it's a way to stay connected. So the system is that whenever I'm on a plane, I shoot those videos before I take off. Another system could be carrying stamp stationery everywhere I go so that I can write a handwritten note to someone and say thank you. Another system could be whenever I get the check from having a meal with someone, if the server has been kind, I will always say, Chris, your service today was amazing. Thank you so much. But it's little tiny systems that I have throughout my day. From a systemized thoughtfulness point of view, is about thinking through how can I make it more deliberate about who deserves my attention. I have calendar appointments with myself to reach out to my top advocates, my clients, my friends. Yeah, I even have a note in there to call my mom. And so I kind of wrap this around what I call systemized thoughtfulness. So yeah. If you think about it as leaders in our organization, maybe it's about creating a one-on-one with someone that you've been meaning to connect with. So put a system in place that you can do it. Maybe it's about doing a six-month check-in with someone who you've been mentoring and you've forgotten about them. But if you put that calendar appointment in, the system is it'll trigger for you a reminder to reach out to them. Maybe you've always wanted to implement a lunch and learn program. So by putting in at least a quarterly lunch and learn program, you're giving yourself a system to then honor that, find a speaker, do a brown bag lunch, and then share some topic that's going to help grow the skills. So there's lots of ways you can be systemized in your thoughtfulness.
Yeah.
And so it applies in our personal life too, Chris. I mean, for people who are fortunate to share their life with someone, maybe that means scheduling a date night. Maybe that means grabbing your partner and planning something really fun. Maybe a system is planning your vacation for a year's time. So we need systems in place. When it comes to your professional attention, Chris, this is where I work with so many of my organizations. A really easy way to be more productive is what I call the 15-minute strategic appointment. So just like you did, you sat down and you reviewed everything that...
We did it with my team as well, actually.
So right, just, so powerful. Yeah. Like, I love that. But one thing I challenge all my leaders to do is every day have a 15-minute appointment with yourself. And here's what you do. In the 15 minutes, you identify your top three not negotiable activities. So before your head hits the pillow tonight, before you fall asleep, what are three things you absolutely must do? Now, these are the things that are going to help you move closer to your goals. So for me, for example, I have a pretty fancy way of managing it. Like, people may want to write this down.
I'm sure you
do. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And believe me, Chris, I've tried every app, every planner, paper, digital, you name it. I've tried it. And here's where I landed.
Okay.
I grabbed myself a little tiny post-it note. I know. It's pretty fancy.
How advanced.
Yeah, it's so advanced. And then at the top, I write, today I will. So it's an agreement with myself.
Great.
And
that's very important for everyone listening, by the way, to just emphasize that point for a second. Today I will. Not I'm going to, or not this. It's very important, that use of language.
Words matter. There's a really great little book by my friend Phil Jones, also from the UK, a brilliant book everyone would love. And it's called Exactly What to Say. And he talks about the power of words, right? So he would be a fun guest for you if you haven't had him on. One of the things that I believe in is these words, this agreement we make with ourselves, is holding ourselves accountable. So a practical tip is set up a 15-minute appointment, grab a post-it note, write your top three things. Now, here's why the post-it note's so powerful, Chris, is because I carry that silly little post-it note all day. It is my decision filtering system, because if I would rather go play on Instagram, for example, which I do love to do for people who want to follow my adventures, that's not going to get me closer to my goals, right? As opposed to preparing a new keynote or a new story for something, or writing a new blog. So I think people just need to think about, like, how are they investing their time and attention? And productive behaviors are new habits that you're forming. In the book, we talk about how to change your habits, how to change your brain, and how to change the way that you're showing up. And these are things that help make people be more productive. So another easy thing people can do to be paying attention more is shorten those stupid meetings that you have. These meetings that are like 2 hours long are just mean. Like, that's just ridiculous, right? My bladder doesn't last for 2 hours. I don't know about anyone else. So we need to think about...
Or our attention span.
Or our attention, yeah. Well, there's this myth out there, Chris, that, you know, our attention span is decreasing, which is total rubbish. It's not true. There's no research to support the fact that our attention spans are declining. Nothing. None. However...
We challenge everyone on LinkedIn listening right now.
Yes, I know. And, like, people are like, oh, no, but our attention spans are decreasing. No, I call that is not true. However, what I did find through the research is that our attention spans are split. So, yeah, Chris, the challenge is it's too many things, right? It's like what you were saying before, honey. And then you realized, hey, if I focused on these things, or if I got some help to do some things, that would make a difference. You know, have you heard that stupid marketing myth that we have the attention span of a goldfish?
I've heard that.
That's just cruel. I mean, that's just stupid. I don't want to be compared to a goldfish. So we need to lose all this stupid language around attention and time. And we need to choose and say, instead of saying to someone, I'm too busy, which is what people say, stop saying that. Because what that's really saying, Chris, is I'm too busy for you.
Start saying,
I'm at capacity right now. Like, just, I'm at capacity. Or, I didn't choose to spend time on that. Although, don't say that to your boss. That may not go over very well. Right? So, I think we need to change our language around our time attention. Stop killing time. Time never did anything to you, right? Time's just this thing that's going to happen. So, if we want to be more practical in the way we apply our attention, really consider, what is your top priorities? What are the goals you want to achieve? How are you investing your time and attention on a daily basis? Put systems in place in your calendar with accountability. And the final thing I would say about the practical systems is find yourself an attention accountability partner. Find yourself someone that you can hold each other accountable for the achievement of your goals. I have a dear friend who every Monday I send her my accountability goals.
I'm sure it's automated.
It's just crazy. It's just like, these are all the things I have to do personally and professionally. And then on Friday, I send it to her
really?
All complete every
That's pretty cool.
Week.
You probably,
yeah, it's cool and scary. So yeah. If there are people here who are watching, you might work for an organization. So your version of that might be, say, for example, you have, as an HR leader, you might report into the C-level. You might every Friday be your own publicist. And what I mean by that, I talk about it in the book, is maybe you send 5 bullet points to your boss every week. And those 5 bullet points, you declare, what are the 5 things you and the team achieved this week? Now, here's what happens. You're proactively communicating what successes you and the team have had. And you know what your boss is probably going to do? Probably going to cut and paste that into their status report. It doesn't matter if your boss doesn't read it. I did this my whole corporate career, because what you're doing is proactively communicating, here's where we spent our attention this week, and here's some things I want to put on your radar. And so what I found when I was in my corporate job, Chris, is that I always got the headcount I asked for. My projects got extended. I got the budgets I needed because I proactively said, hey, Chris, this needs your attention. Here's what I'm working on. And I was proactively communicating. Now, if you are an entrepreneur watching this, or maybe you freelance, maybe you work with different organizations, holding yourself accountable maybe isn't enough some days. So find an accountability partner.
It's funny because my next question was going to be, how do you achieve maximum accountability?
Oh my God. See, I love that you and I are so in sync. I love that.
That was the question. So is there any other ways of doing that? That's a great one. I think
make it public.
I do it with Shane, who's my co-founder. We do that weekly, and we also do it with one of our investors. And we all commit to what we're going to achieve, and then we meet the week. We meet face to face weekly to keep each other accountable.
I love that.
Yeah,
that's so cool.
And because in the beginning, the first year was a bit of a, I'm not afraid to say it. It was a bit of a disaster. We kind of were just running everything like most startups and entrepreneurs, and we were getting stuff done, but we just weren't efficient. Right. And there's a big difference. And again, when you have those meetings, so many things that you have that you were going to do just get thrown out. Like, actually, that's not a priority right now.
Exactly.
Or I can delegate that in my,
yes.
Etc. And it's just been a bit of a game. And also, it means that I can focus on things that I enjoy.
Yes, exactly. And what you
where I value, and where I add value personally as Chris.
Exactly. Chris, I think that's the key. I think with accountability, yes, have an accountability partner. And that could be to achieve a goal. It might be a fitness goal. It might be a health goal. It might be a promotional goal. It might be a training and development goal. But have someone that you trust that has the right to question you about whether you're doing it or not, right? And then hold yourself accountable to them. But my best tip for accountability is make it public, because public accountability drives private accountability. Now, here's how I do that in my own life. At the time of recording, I decided to embark on an elimination program called Whole30. It's basically clean eating, right? Now, I could have just very quietly done that, and I didn't. I bravely put it on Instagram. I put it on Facebook. I have a friend who's an accountability partner, and I told my husband and my friends. Now, I am a girl who loves her champagne. This is just my reality.
You should definitely be out with my wife then.
Yes, I already love your wife because she's on Instagram and fabulous. So when you think about, it's just about eliminating that. Now, what that actually has helped me do is when my client said, does that mean we're not drinking champagne next week at dinner? And I was like, that's absolutely what's happening, but we will celebrate for sure. So I think this public accountability not just helps me because I've said to the world I will do this. I did the same thing when I ran a marathon. Oh, by the way, started to take up running. Never run before in my life. Stupid, crazy. And then ran a marathon within 5 months. Why? Because I told the world I would do it. So hold yourself accountable. Internal accountability is powerful, but also external accountability can help drive your behavior, because you don't want to let down the people that you suggested that you would do this with. So think about that as a strategy.
Yeah. It's the same as when I'm talking about to the team about our vision and our goals as a business and where we're going, I'm putting it out there to all of them. And they're
holding you accountable.
Yeah, exactly. And you think about the large companies that we both work with, when their CEOs are talking about, you know, this is where we're going, this is what it looks like, this is what it means for you and us as a business, they're doing that.
Yeah, and one thing that I think a lot of leaders find challenging that I work with, because I work with very, very senior leaders of major Fortune 100 companies, and many of them, I'm their accountability partner. Now, here's what I mean by that. We will pay for accountability. They need a confidential coach or mentor that they can talk honestly with. Right. And so when you think about that, sometimes as a leader and in HR, we hold all the secrets. We are so private. Right. And I think we need someone we can talk to as well. But I think that when it comes to truly being maximizing your accountability, know how you're driven. Are you internal or external? Find an accountability partner. Tell the world and then report back and celebrate your success. Because it's one thing to say you'll do something, but don't forget the step where we stop and celebrate that you achieved that. As HR leaders, many of them, they're running from one project to the next. They don't have a chance to celebrate. They helped someone get promoted. They implemented a new program. They totally re-engineered the employee benefit scheme. Often they're just so busy running. We don't stop and go, oh, wow, I just did that.
To be honest, that's one of the reasons I started the show. Because HR does a really bad job of sharing the great work that it does, and I spent, you know, 10 years speaking to these guys on the phone, hearing this incredible work and the projects they're doing, you know, changing literally millions of people's lives around the world.
They are the heart of an organization.
Yeah, and I said they're really bad at sharing. that's literally why we started the show in the first place as well. Any other guidance on improving sort of daily attention?
Yes, absolutely. A couple of things I would suggest is find out what your distractions are. For example, if you are a person who likes to be on social media more than you like updating a report, then, which is probably everyone. So one thing that I would suggest is find web blocking softwares that work for you. I use an app called Freedom. It blocks all websites for me and only allows me to work on a particular thing. So find web blocking software. Do time blocking. Time blocking meaning I'll just work on this for 15 minutes and give it my undivided attention. Do whatever I can to get it done, knocked out, finished, or at least progressed in 15 minutes. So apply the 15-minute rule. I use the timer on my phone. I literally will set, and I know it sounds ridiculous, but I will set the timer on my iPhone, and then when the 15 minutes goes off, I'm like, okay, done. Great, move on. So play a game with this, right? Don't take yourself so seriously. Other practical things that you can do is stop saying yes to so many meetings. Now, if you are not required, you know, in corporate,
you're included in it, but you're like,
Like you're an optional attendee. Don't you optional me. If you optional me, I'm out. Like, you either want me there or you don't want me there. And I think, too, we need to take control of that, because as leaders, and when I use the word leader, you don't have to have a fancy title to be a leader. You are a leader in your home, your church, your temple, your community, your workplace. Every one of us are leaders. So when I use the word leader, I mean everybody. We have the opportunity to, when we get a meeting invitation, is ask the person who invited us, what's my role in the meeting? What do you need me to prepare in advance? What's the agenda of the meeting? How long will the meeting be? What do you want me to do in the meeting? What's my role in the meeting? And we can ask them like 10 questions. And I used to do this all my corporate life, and I do it to my team too. And sometimes they'll be like, oh, for goodness sake, just don't come. And I'm like, okay. People don't think it through. We're so scared of hurting people's feelings. We're so polite, right? We're so polite, we're going to invite everyone because goodness knows we don't want to offend anyone. We don't want to hurt their feelings. But in advance, it would be so much more proactive. If those four people, you could have said to those four people, hey, we're recording this call. If you'd like to watch it afterwards, you're most welcome. But there is no role for you in this particular meeting. So please enjoy the next 90 minutes on your own. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's crazy. So let's shorten our meetings if you want to fix your attention. Have a really great agenda if you have meetings. Please give people specific roles, start and end times for their agenda. Have minutes of
meeting. And a reason for the meeting.
Oh, hallelujah. And put it in the meeting request. So if you are going to ask someone to give you their time, don't you dare steal minutes from them by not having an actual purpose. So with all of my teams I work with, I always tell them that every meeting needs to have a purpose of the meeting. It needs to be actually written in the invitation, right? Uh-huh. And then the pre-work needs to be included as well. Instead of all these meetings where people sit around and have a status meeting, where nothing has changed from one week to the next. Well, if nothing's changed, cancel the meeting. It's stupid. Don't waste people's time because you're stealing minutes from them, minutes they will never get back.
I appreciate all of this, everything we've been speaking about for the last 32 minutes will inevitably lead and increase profitability. But is there any specific strategies that you focus on with these companies around this?
Yeah, when it comes to profitability, when we think about like the, let's just do the flip of that, the costs of not paying attention.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
Yeah. And so when you think about from an HR point of view, you know that it takes an enormous amount of resources to be able to attract and retain that top talent. So if you want to be a company who really is best place to work and is getting that and it is easier to recruit, then you need to pay attention, because if you're not, you're losing these people that you're investing in. You don't have the succession planning in place that you need in order for them to move through the organization. You invest all this time in their learning and development and send them to these programs and develop these programs, and then someone else gets the benefit of them. So if you don't have great attraction and retention strategies, say, for example, you don't even have a great onboarding program, then you've spent all this time and money and then you don't actually get the return on that investment. So there are true costs of not paying attention. There's costs in a productivity point of view, right? So there is some research we discovered when we were writing the book, Attention Pays, that when people are multitasking, their productivity can go down 40 to 50%, which is heart-wrenching to me. What we also discovered that freaked me out is that every time we ask our brain to switch tasks, it takes on average 23 minutes. Now calculate that.
To switch. Wow. Okay.
So we're still trying to think about the thing that we're switching on. We haven't even made progress. And so there's a true cost to that, right? There's also a cost to when you think about employee engagement. You know, we have these amazing surveys where we ask the team, hey, what are you thinking about them? And then we spend all this money on collating the research. And then often we don't actually do anything and declare with them what we did and discovered and what changes we made as a result. And I work with so many big corporates, and they all have their version of whatever that survey is. And the HR leaders are doing their due diligence and discovering what's happening here, what's the morale, what's the engagement, what learning needs do we have, how are your leaders showing up. But unless we report back to those same people and say, hey, we paid attention to what you said, here's some things we're going to implement as a result. But no, the next year rolls around, they ask the same questions, they ask us, and then they wonder, why is engagement not high? Why aren't people completing the survey? Well, because you never told them what you did with it last time. So there's costs of not paying attention. Yeah. What I see happens is, if you think about true profitability, companies that have a sales force, if you pay attention to them, if they're getting the development and the mentoring they need, their average sale is going to increase. Their retention of clientele, where they're going to have that repeat client, is going to increase. If you think about investing in the front line, the people who are actually serving your clients, your customers, your members, your patients, if you're investing in their development, giving them the attention they need for the skill development they need, they are more likely to remain loyal to you because they feel like you see them, you hear them. And Chris, that's what it's about. Yeah. Every person on this planet, all they want is to be seen and heard. And that, if you take care of that, will ultimately lead to not just being more productive, not just being accountable, but also companies making more money.
You also say, you're talking about a simple framework to get your team aligned and focus on your advisor. Because we're talking about, a lot of what we spoke about is individually. How do we do this on a team basis?
Yeah, I think that as leaders, we're many of my clients now are operating in a matrix environment. And so, for example, you as the HR, you might be the heart of the organization, but you might find yourself reporting to multiple people. Or you may have access to resources that don't report to you, but they are responsible for helping you deliver on projects, right? And so when you think about matrix organizations, they bring their own set of complication, but it still comes back to connection. So it's about making sure you've got systems in place, for example, regular one-on-ones. It's about making sure if you're having a team meeting that it's a powerful and productive team meeting, that you are all very aware. Chris, you said you tell the whole team about the goals. One of my media clients, one of the things I always loved was whenever I was with them or any learning and development opportunity they ever had, they always threw the company goals up on the slide, the first thing, so everyone could see, here's how I impact that. Right? So one thing that you can do as a team is keep those goals front and center, but also to make sure you take time to debrief any projects you work on together. What was good, what was bad, what was ugly, and debrief it to learn for next time. Also make sure that you're paying attention to the timing of people. So if you are watching that some people in your team have a very full workload on certain parts of the day or month, and then other teams don't. So have the opportunity to balance it out. One particular accounting client that I have, they actually own manufacturing clients around the world. And when I work with their finance team, they notice there's certain times in a finance month that are ridiculous and everyone's working like crazy. And then there's other times where they have downtime. And so they were able to match people up with talent so that they could then all have a more consistent experience over the month through having a calendar that they all contributed to. That simple technique that we implemented made such a big difference to their workflow. So being really aware, also be conscious of things like vacations and holidays you have, right? So around the holiday season, cancel those unnecessary meetings. Make sure people know what they need to do to get to the end of the year. The time of recording when we're doing this, it's beautiful because it's the start of the last quarter. And if you really want to finish your quarter strong, how about bringing everyone together, reset what the goals are to achieve before the end of the year. Make sure you've invested all the monies that you're not going to lose for next year in your budget. Make sure you've invested in learning and development. Make sure that people know how to make the next year start strong by finishing this year strong. Don't limp into the holidays. I feel like sometimes it's September, then it's Christmas or Hanukkah or whatever you celebrate. Like all of a sudden that happens, right? Yeah. And so we have to avoid that. So when it comes to getting the team aligned, start with what the objectives are. What really matters to you as a team? What talent do you have now? What gaps do you have? What deficiencies do you need to be able to overcome? And then put a plan in place for the next 90 days. Every team I've ever run, every team I've ever supported, every executive I've ever worked with, I talk to them in 90-day cycles. Because we can literally change behaviors. We can change our habits in 90 days. They say it takes 21 days to make a new habit, which is not true. It's 100% false. On average,
I don't believe that at all because it depends what you do in the day.
Yeah, it's 66 days on average to get a new habit formed. So that's why I love this period of 90 days. So if you want to get the team aligned, talk to them in 90-day cycles. What are we doing for the next 90 days? So that way you finish the quarter strong, you're all aligned, and that will give you the opportunity to really pay attention to what matters. And also to your point you made earlier today, Chris, say no to the things that don't.
No, we can talk forever and I don't want to keep you too long. Is there anything else you want to add that we've missed out on? Do you think that we need to share with the listeners right now? I think they have about a million different practical things they can go away and do, which I love. This is what I love about speaking to you, because everything you talk about is practical and people can do right now. I think it's so important. Is there anything else you want to add before
you
wrap up?
I think, you know, the best advice I ever got, Chris, was I was sitting in my next door neighbor's house. Her name's Eileen, and she and I were just attempting to have a cup of coffee uninterrupted. She had like a little 5-year-old, his name's Donovan. And Donovan kept inserting himself into the conversation all the time. And he kept asking me all these questions and I was answering him, but he got so mad because he didn't think I was listening, right? He got so mad at me. He was like, Neen, you have to pay attention to me. You're not listening. Ugh, I was. If you've ever debated with a 5-year-old, you know exactly what I'm talking about. This is something in your future, Chris. So yeah. He got so mad at me though. He jumped in my lap. He grabbed my face. He turned it towards him and he said this. He said, Neen, listen with your eyes. He was fine.
Yeah.
Chris, it took a 5-year-old to remind me, we don't just listen with our ears, we listen with our eyes, we listen with our heart, we listen with our soul. And I think as leaders in our organization, in our church, community, temple, wherever we are, in our homes, we have this responsibility to be more intentional with our attention, which means we have to listen with our eyes even more than we have done in the past.
Amazing. I'm waiting for Robin to say that to me now in 4 years' time. Well, thanks so much, Neen. I really appreciate you taking the time to join us. I always love speaking with you. Your energy is infectious. And I'm sure everyone probably listening can agree as well. I think, I don't know where you get it all from, but you're clearly passionate about what you do and you love what you do because it kind of shines through as well. For everyone listening, where can they, because I think there's two things, right? One, I know they can check you out over at neenjames.com website, right?
Yeah.
And then secondly, there's a free giveaway that you have for everyone listening, right?
Right. Well, because we were talking about productivity today, because I know everyone wants to get more done, what Chris and I have organized for you is a complimentary copy of my book, Folding Time. So I will provide that to Chris. He'll put it in the show notes for you as a PDF. So you can all get a copy of Folding Time. So that's our gift to you.
Yeah, but they have to promise they got action on it.
Yeah, do something with it. Like, that would be really fun. Imagine if you all sent us notes to say what you did as a result of this call today. Ooh, if you told us what you did because you listened to something we chatted about, that would just make my heart sing. I would love that.
Thank you for everyone for listening. Thank you, Neen, for joining us. It was a pleasure as always. Everything that we've been discussing will be in the links in the description for you guys on LinkedIn. And also, if you're subscribed to the podcast, whether it's Google Play, iTunes, SoundCloud, Spotify, it will all be in there for you as well. So apart from that, Neen, thanks again. And I wish you all the best until we next chat.
Thank you. Thanks for everything you do in the world, Chris.